Welcome back, guys. Today I'm back in Munich at the day of recording. It's the 31st December of this year, so the last day of the new year. Today with my wife, today I'm just going in the city, getting my last stuff ready for New Year's Eve. We are very much looking forward. But today I want to fulfill a promise to you, because if you have seen my last video on the goals for the new year, you know that one of my main goals is also to keep my personal finances healthy, and a big important part of that is my net worth. And I received many comments from you guys asking you to share this net worth tracker of mine, how I do this, what my system is to keep this in order. So today I'm going to do exactly that. I do think it can be a life-changing video. I know this is quite a bold claim, but nevertheless, I believe this is what was the case for me when I started a couple of years ago to do this in this systematic way. So welcome back to another coffee break here on my channel, Firm Learning. My name is Heinrich, and on my channel, I want to help you to become successful in the first years of your career. I'm a former McKinsey consultant, and I talk about all things management, career, consulting, but I do want to help you to get your personal finances in order as well. So without further ado, let's jump into it. I will show you the tool that I use for myself to track my net worth. And yes, in the very end of the video, I will show you an option where you can actually download the tool for yourself, for your use. So if you find this helpful, watch until the end to see this download option as well. I'm back home now and have my notebook here in front of me, so I will now look down here on the PC. And what you see here is already the full version of the network tracking sheet that I was talking about. And don't be discouraged, this might look a bit complicated and crazy at first, but I will break it down for you, I will simplify it for you. What you see here is now a version for 2020, and then on the right I already extended it for the next year, just to show you how then you could also continue to track all of this going forward. Now to simplify it and to go over it in detail, let me just close this down, group this together, and now just zoom in here on the 2020 part. You see that there are already some numbers here filled for 2020, just two important remarks. So first of all, these are of course not my numbers. I pretty much made all these numbers up. And second, let's please now not talk about whether these numbers are too high or too low, whether these numbers are realistic or not. This is not about the specific numbers that you see, but it's rather about the overall methodology, the overall logic of tracking all of this. So you see that there are two parts here, the upper part that tracks the net worth, and then the lower part that tracks the cash flow. In the strict sense, the only thing that's really relevant for your net worth is this upper part, though I do believe that for your personal finances, it is important to get an understanding of your cash flow, so your income and your expenses as well. So let's start with the net worth. What is actually your net worth? And the simple answer to that is that the net worth is the difference between your assets and your liabilities. So now we're going to look together into what exactly this means, but the net worth pretty much is how rich you are, right? What is the value of all your holdings? What is the value of everything that you have against your name? So again, looking back into this sheet, you can see that it takes as a formula the sum of your assets and it subtracts the sum of your liabilities. So this is here what the net worth is, and then the growth is just tracking the percentage difference month on month. So let's look into these two areas, assets and liabilities, in detail. Let's start with the assets. So what you see here now is a structure of assets that probably works for many people, but of course, if now you track this for yourself, just ask yourself, what are the assets that you actually own? And then of course, feel free to delete whole sections or maybe even add additional sections if you feel like the specific assets that you own do not really fit into the scheme, right? But this is just something that I believe is generally applicable and works for many people. So let's start with your deposits. So this is just the accounts with banks or any other accounts that you hold that pretty much have cash on them. So in this example here, there are two checking accounts, one at the Deutsche Bank, one at the Commerzbank. Then there is a savings account, and then here you might have some money on your PayPal. Again, you might have more accounts, you might have fewer accounts. Just insert every account in a line and then just track every month how much money you have on it. What I personally do not track is the cash that I have with me at any point in time. So this would of course be part of your net worth as well. Personally, I just see this as a little extra that I have, and I do not specifically track this here. So far, so good. Let's look into the next section, financial instruments. And here you can pretty much add all the stocks, all the ETFs, all the funds, all these securities that you own. What exactly this this is and how many different positions you have, of course, can depend. So if you are interested how I specifically think about this whole investment topic, I made a whole video about investments for young professionals. I will link it somewhere above here, so have a look if this is of value for you. Of course, I need to make the overall disclaimer that this is not investment advice. I'm not an investment professional. So please do your own research before investing in anything. Next is real estate. And maybe you are lucky or successful enough to own some real estate, maybe some apartments or even full houses. Then I would add each object that you own in a separate line and then add the value of that object in the different columns. With assets like this, I would in general assume that the value stays rather constant over time. And then probably every year or so, you can just look into it and then potentially make some adjustments as necessary. Of course, now if you purchase real estate, you often take a loan, a mortgage to finance that. And this is what will come into play in the liability section. So we're going to talk about that in a moment as well. Next, digital assets. Maybe you own some digital assets like Bitcoin. Again, no financial advice, no recommendation. You do your own research. But here as well, you could add each asset that you own in the lines and then track the value. Personally, I'm quite passionate about digital assets and blockchain technology. I made a full video course explaining what blockchain technology is all about and how it works. Also, how it can be used in the business world with different use cases. So if you're interested in this video course, check out the video description below to the link to this Udemy course of mine. Next, commodities. So maybe you own some physical commodities, for instance, gold or silver, some gold coins or anything like that. Here again, you can track the value. And then I would recommend you to every half a year or every year or so, just look into the figures, update it according to the current market value. Next, additional objects of value. So the classical example here would be a car, or maybe you also own an expensive watch or an expensive piece of art or anything like that. This could be the place where you list these objects. Here, of course, be careful that you do not fool yourself. So in general, all consumer products that you own, all expensive pieces of clothing, all of this I would not list here, even if you might be able to get some money for it if you would sell it. Often the actual market value of these objects would be significantly smaller than what you might believe it is. So as a best practice, I would just not include these things, treat them as a little buffer that you have if things go really south, and only include things where you really know that they will have a significant market value. And this is of course true for cars as well. The problem with cars is that their value will go down rapidly over time. So make sure that you update the value of your car if you want to list it here at all every half a year or so, just to make sure that you're not fooling yourself. So the next section in your assets are your receivables. So again, some people might not have anything like this. A receivable could, for instance, be an expense claim. So what I mean by that when I was in consulting, I was pretty lazy and I only handed in my expenses every couple of months or so, which meant that my expense claims at the time had at least 4 digits. Let's just put it this way, guys. So of course, this is a claim that you have. This is a receivable that you have. And this might be something that you want to list in such an overview as well. Of course, up to the moment when then you get the money, as for instance, here in this example in April, where then the expense claim would go to 0. But then, of course, you will have the cash on one of your accounts listed here somewhere above. Then another receivable might be a loan that you are giving to somebody else. So maybe you want to help out a family member or a colleague or a friend of yours, and you decided to give him a loan. And then, of course, the value of the principal of that loan would be an asset, a receivable for you as well. Now, of course, assuming that you can have the reasonable expectation that this will be paid back to you at some point in time. So this is the overview of the assets. Again, this can look very different for your specific situation. Of course, adapt this to your specific needs, to the asset classes that you own, but this is the overall idea. So I'm currently here in the kitchen. We are getting ourselves ready for a nice little New Year's Eve dinner. Only the two of us, my wife and I. So I hope though that this video inspired you to start your investment game as well, if it did not start yet. And there are two services that I can recommend for you. So if you live in the US, there is Webull. And if you actually sign up there via the link in the video description, I believe at the moment they give you even up to 4 free stocks. So just for signing up. So have a look at that. And then for the German speaking people, there is Trade Republic. This is also a service where they have almost no fees at all for investing in stocks, in ETFs. Again, link in the video description. Check it out if this interests for you. But now let's look into the liabilities as well. For the liabilities, I have 3 categories that now I want to talk about today. The first is the consumer debt. Probably the most common example of consumer debt is the open balance on your credit cards. So at the time when you update this every single month, just look into your credit cards and see what the open balance of your cards is at that specific point in time. And then this open balance that you still owe, this is then what you should include here. Of course, if you have any other consumer loans, any other consumer debt, this is what you could include in additional lines here as well. Regarding consumer debt, of course, I trust I do not need to tell you that this really should be avoided. If you just use a credit card as a means of payment and then just pay off the balance at the end of every month, but do not just start buying things on credit that you actually cannot afford at the moment, just with the perspective of hopefully paying for it later at any point in time. Next is the real estate debt. So in this example where you own these two apartments in Düsseldorf, there might still be a certain amount that you owe towards these apartments. And this is then of course the debt that you have if you financed it via a loan. So here make sure that you track every month what the open balance is on these loans in order to correctly show the picture here of your personal finances. Now another type of debt that now I don't have in this example, but that you could also add are of course student loans. So if you have student loans which still have an open balance, of course then list this as an additional line item within your liabilities as well. And the last point I want to talk about regarding liabilities are the accrued taxes. So this would probably not be so relevant if you're an employee. But if you are self-employed, of course, you do not have an employer who directly deducts income taxes from your paycheck, but you often need to pay the income tax at the end of the year. And depending on the size of your business, this can sum up to a very significant amount. So if you're self-employed, make sure that you have a good understanding of what your tax obligations will be at the end of the year. And then, of course, in such an overview, make sure that you also track what the current sum of the tax obligations in the current year is, because, of course, this needs to be deducted to then get to your net worth. So that's it, guys. This is how it works. This is how you calculate your net worth. You just add the sum of all your assets and then subtract from it the sum of all your liabilities. But now let's dig a little bit deeper, because indeed to really get your personal finances right, I believe it is crucial to also get a good understanding of your cash flow. And the way I look into this is by looking into my income, my recurrent payments, and my investments. So what exactly does this mean? So first of all, under income, you have all the money that you earn every month. So for most people, this will be a full-time job. Then you might also have some income from a self-employment. And maybe you have some other side gigs, some other side hustles that you have. You might, for instance, be renting out a room in your home at Airbnb. So the sum of all of this is your income. So what I do, for instance, for my self-employment is that I have a new specific tab where I model all the income and the expenses from my self-employment. And then I take the profit and then link it into this line. So for a self-employment like that, of course, this should only be the profit. But then, of course, you still have the problem with the taxes, because usually then the profit from your self-employment will, of course, be a gross figure. So will be a figure before taxes. And also on other income from side hustles, for instance, Airbnb, you will often need to pay taxes on that. So for these reasons, I here included a line that roughly calculates the value of the taxes on this gross income. So here you should include your marginal tax rate. So in my case, if you already have a full-time job, this will easily be around 40% in Germany. And then you deduct these taxes from your income to get a better understanding of what your real after-tax, your net income really is. And also see how this links together with the liabilities with the accrued taxes, because what I do here is that I pretty much just add up the value of all these taxes up to the current month in that year. And this is then also the way how I come up with these accrued taxes that I then add in as liability for the net worth calculation. So this is the income. So what's next that I have? Next, I have an overview of all my recurring payments. And here, of course, what exactly this is might differ significantly by person. You're just a generic example. You might have some living expenses, so rent, utilities, maybe some cleaning costs. Then you might have some services that you use. So for instance, university fees, some fitness center memberships, Netflix, Audible, some other services that you might use. And so what you see here, what I do is that every payment I calculate as a monthly payment. So if it's charged yearly, for instance, university fees, then I divide the figure by 12 to understand really what the average costs each month are. And then I include here as an information whether this is a yearly or a monthly charge, and if it is a yearly charge, in which month it is charged, just for me to not get confused and to know when these things will hit my bank account. Next, insurances. So for instance, payments for health insurance or liability insurance that you have, and then some other recurring payments, for instance, mobile phone, banking account fees, or anything like that. So these recurring payments are all the payments that for sure will be deducted from my bank account every month, every quarter, every year. So these are the things that I cannot influence on a daily basis. But of course, you can influence this in the medium term. And this for me already was a big revelation when I put this together for the first time, that I realized that I had all these little charges from some memberships, some other subscriptions I maybe signed up for 1 or 2 years ago, which I wasn't really using at the time. So just transparently transparency about this is really crucial, and then always asking yourself whether you're really still using this or whether you can delete or cancel this. So next section is the investment. So what are all the payments related to saving, related to investments that you do every month? And in this example, you might pay an annuity towards the real estate loan that you took to buy the two apartments in Düsseldorf. And then these will come with some monthly payment that will hit your bank account every single month. And then you also might decide to participate in a stock investment plan where every month a certain fixed amount is taken from a bank account and automatically invested into certain ETFs or certain funds that you selected. This for sure is how I manage my savings, how I manage my investments. I do not ask myself at the end of every month how much money I have left, what my possibilities are now in order to do some investments, but I have these fixed commitments that are directly deducted from my bank account directly after my salary comes in. So it's pretty much a given that I will invest these amounts every single month, and then it's up to me to figure out how can I live with the rest. Because of course, now what this means is that the cash flow that you get here on top by taking the income, then subtracting the recurring payments and subtracting the investments, this is all the money that is available to you for all your daily discretionary purchases. So of course, this might also be some important stuff like food or clothing or some other things that you will need to pay every month, but it's just not automatically deducted from your bank account. But then this can, of course, also be all these other fun activities like going on vacation, going to a restaurant, maybe having a great night out with your friends. In the end, all of this needs to be paid via this free cash flow that you have here. So what I started to do in the beginning is to really track every month also all these expenses. So by going over all my card expenses, by really tracking down every day what I spend the money for. But frankly, then it took me so long at the end of every month to compile this into such an overview. For me, this was not worth the time. I'm happy with this approach where I now just have this number that I know is available for me for all this discretionary spend. And then of course, what I did to challenge myself is that whenever this number was increasing to a level where I felt I do not really need to spend all this money on discretionary stuff, then I was increasing my monthly savings commitments. I was increasing the amount of my monthly stock investment plan so that then over time, of course, you want to have the share of your investments as high as possible, because this is what will influence, what will drive your net worth in the long term. And then whatever is left, this is then the amount that you can use to live your life. Of course, it's great to have a nice night out, to go to a nice restaurant. So you need to find your personal balance that you can do all of these things to an extent that they satisfy you, but also keep track of your financial goals to keep your savings rate high and increase the net worth of you over time. So as promised, I will give you the opportunity to download this tracking tool for your personal use as well. There is a download link below in the video description, so check it out if this interests you. As always, if you have any questions about what we just discussed, feel free to write me a comment below in the comment section. I will answer to every single comment. And as you know, if you write a comment, this also helps me with the YouTube systems, so every comment is warmly appreciated. In addition to that, if you took any value out of this video at all, please hit the like button for the YouTube algorithm and also subscribe to the channel to stay up to date on all the content. If you want to see even more from me, I also have an Instagram. My handle is firmlearning. I also have a mailing list. You can sign up to that in the video description as well. And you can also reach out to me on LinkedIn. Again, the link to that is in the video description. I now want to say thank you to all the members of the channel. You're really making a considerable impact and contribution to my work. This is very much appreciated. If you want to become a member as well, hit the join button next to the subscribe button to learn about all the member-only perks that you get as a member. So I release new videos every single Saturday. See you back again here on this channel next week. Looking forward to that. Until then, good weekend, and of course, a great new year 2021 to all of you. Cheers, guys. This is Heinrich from Firm Learning.